Buenos días, bienvenidos al monte. Todos se pueden sentar, por favor, y le quiero dar la bienvenida a todos que nos están visitando a través de Facebook.
Yes, what he said. Hey, good morning, church. Welcome to the Mount today. I want to welcome you here, our Stafford campus. I want to welcome Pastor Andrew and Pastor Caleb down at Fredericksburg. I want to welcome all of our online family. And as Pastor Yayo's done, I want to welcome our El Monte family as well. Hey, it is good to be with you today. I've invited Pastor Yayo to join me today as we get a chance to kind of do a little team preaching today. And then later at 2 o'clock, we're going to be up in our chapel like every Sunday. And I'm going to join them in our Spanish-speaking El Monte service. And so I am so glad that you're a part of what God is doing here today. Hey, listen, we're going to finish our comeback series. If you have a Bible and you can find it, we're going to be in Acts chapter 28. Acts chapter 28. And as you turn there, we're going to have a chance, obviously, to finish out this series. But let me give you a little preview for next week. Next week, we're going to begin a new series, and I think it's going to be a right-on-time series for all of us. It is on the names of God. We're going to put our attention, our affection on who God says he is, and we're going to look at his names. And as we look at his name, we're going to see his character, and I believe God's going to reveal just a steadiness that is lacking right now in our world and in his days. And I think God wants to show us himself so that we can walk a little bit more in step with him. Come on. This is going to be a series I hope you'll just tune in and let God maybe show some himself to you in the coming days together. But today, we get a chance to share with you together. I don't know if you know this, but Pastor Yayo and I, we actually sermon prep every week together because we want to be faithful in delivering God's truth to you and in Spanish as well as in English on Sunday mornings, and we just want God to be lifted up, and Amen. We hope that that will happen even here this morning.
Amen. Well, Pastor, thank you for this series. It has been a very helpful series as we restart our physical gatherings and continue doing our online community as well. Like last week, you mentioned this. This season and this series is a wake-up call to repent, maturity, and a new way of living. Today, we are going to give you an opportunity to move forward with Jesus Christ, and I pray that you will do. And let me remind you of a truth that we covered a couple of weeks ago. And he says this right here. You can make progress or make excuses, but you can't make both. Now, let's say it together. You can make progress or make excuses, but
you can't make both.
Oh, we got a full house today. Last week, we ended our sermon with Paul and 276 people shipwrecked on the shores of Malta. And today, we are going to continue this journey. And as God promised, all lives were saved. Isn't that amazing? God keeps keeping his promise. And now let me continue with the journey. They stayed in 3 months in Malta and then began again. Now let's check this map out. They will sail, and this is going to go all over here because this is his last journey trip or third missionary trip. So they will sail. They will sail to the port of Naples, then travel on foot 125 miles along the Appian Way. Now, I want you to pay attention to this. God uses the Greek culture through Alexander the Great and the Roman roads to advance the good news throughout the ancient world. Isn't that amazing?
You see what that means? That means God can use a local government. He can use a local culture. He can use leaders to kind of make this thing happen. I mean, Greek culture, Roman culture, that's anti-God. Yet God used it to what? To bring good news of Jesus Amen. Christ. Man, that's timely.
And that's how God works in mysterious ways. Now let's listen to Acts 28. There we found some brothers and sisters who invited us to spend a week with them. And so we came to Rome. The brothers and sisters there had heard that they were coming, and they traveled as far as the Forum of the Appius and the Tree Taverns to meet us. At the sight of these people, Paul thanked God and was encouraged. When we got to Rome, Paul was allowed to live by himself with a soldier to guard him. Pastor, did you hear this? Did you guys hear this? Paul makes it to Rome. And when he gets to Rome, guess what? He gets quarantined.
It's biblical. Come on. It's biblical. You are right. He does get to Rome. He's under house arrest, which means he can't leave. And he's chained to a Roman guard. They're watching him every 6 hours. And so he's in this kind of situation. Yeah, he was quarantined, but he didn't have to wear a mask. And he actually could welcome guests. Guests could actually come into his home and still visit him, even though he was kind of contained and confined there in his home. Now, I thought about this. Here you got a missionary that's trying to go to all these places to bring good news, and then now you put a missionary on house arrest. It would be easy for Paul to say, well, I guess I'm done, right? I guess this is over, because he's there waiting for his trial. And as he's waiting there, what does a missionary do when you're stuck at home? But like we've already said, you can make progress or you can make excuses, but you can't make both. And in this situation, Paul is facing quarantine. That's what I want to talk about today. We're going to look at several things he's facing and see how it maybe relates to what we're facing. Anybody out there facing quarantine right now? Anybody out there, something got turned down in your life? Something got turned off? Something that you're usually active doing you can't do right now? Listen, I think all of us at some level can relate to something being silenced. This is exactly what's happening with Paul. He's under house arrest, and I wonder who out there today says, I'm under house arrest too. I'm working from home right now. Or I'm under house arrest, and I got to go to school tomorrow on Zoom, right? And you're feeling that tension of maybe not being able to do all the things that you used to could do. And so in this moment, Paul decides to make progress instead of making an excuse. I want you to see this. Because this would have been very easy for him to go, sorry guys, I can't go out there and do anything today, so I guess I'm no longer a missionary. Sorry, I'm under house arrest. I'm just going to be stuck here at home. And just as that would have been tempting for Paul, it's also tempting for you and me. Mm. During this season, for us to what? To shut down our goals, to turn off our dreams, to stop living up to our commitments. Why? Because, well, I guess I can't do anything about it now. It'd be so easy for us to retreat in this season versus to find progress. And I know not just with those things, I think this could be a season, it'd be very tempting to pull away from spiritual things. I think this is a perfect season to grow, but some of us might be going, we can't meet as a group anymore, so I guess I can't come and worship like I used to, so I guess I can't. And all of a sudden, we can use the excuses versus moving forward in our faith. Listen, I know it's easy because right now, life feels like it is on hold. Come on, school is virtual. Who had ever seen that? And it feels like even our society is unwilling to seek progress. And so in that, we want it to give us permission to not do what we could do. I'm going to ask it this way this morning. Pastor Yayo, what could be accomplished in 2020? What could be accomplished in you and through you in 2020? Now, to give you an example, I'm going to go back a few centuries, and I wonder if anybody here today at Stafford or Fredericksburg, have you ever heard of a guy named Isaac Newton? Isaac Newton. Come on, anybody? Come on, you don't admit you're smart, but come on, put your hand in the air. He's kind of a handsome dude. I want you to check him out here. And I want to share this illustration about his life because this is insightful to me. Because you might not know this, but there was a time when Isaac Newton got social distance from his college and got sent home for a season of time. And I want you to see what he accomplished in that interrupted life. It says this, Isaac Newton was a college student during the Great Plague of London in 1665. Although it took us about another 200 years for doctors to understand what caused the sickness, many folks in that time had enough sense to at least send the college students home. And so it's interesting that Newton got sent home, and that's when the magic actually happened. Now, he was a student at Cambridge there, and he was sent home to his manor, the Woolsthorpe Manor, which was a family estate about 60 miles northwest from the campus. And without teachers there to help him, that's actually when Newton flourished. You see, the year that he spent away was later referred to, and there's this Latin word that I'm not even going to attempt to pronounce, but it's known as the Year of Wonder. You see, in that year, the first thing that happened is that he took some math problems home that his teachers gave him, and he kept working on them. Come on, teenagers, isn't that what y'all like to do in your breaks? Just give me some more math, and I'm going to work on some math, right? You know what he did? As he worked home with math, that's where he began to work on some things, and the things that he discovered later become the creation of calculus. Now you know who to blame, right? Isaac Newton, give him a little free time and watch what happens. Now, it doesn't stop there. While he was at home, he also acquired some prisms. He began experimenting them in his own room. Listen to this, kids. He bore holes in the shutters so a small beam of light could shine into his room. It was there through explorations that emerged the theories of optics. Come on. So you can tear up your house and learn things. Listen, there's a third thing that happened, and this is kind of the legend about him that we do know about, that outside his window stood an apple tree. And the rumor is he was outside one day, he watched an apple fall from the tree, and it was there while sitting under that tree, it launched his thinking. It helped him to develop the theory of the law of gravity and the laws of motion. Come on, back in London, a fourth of the population will go on to die because of the plague. Horrible. Yet at the same time, all these discoveries that come out of Isaac Newton become benefits to us centuries later. Do you know that he did return back to school in 1667, and 2 years later, he didn't just receive a degree, he became a professor. I mean, come on, what are you gonna do with 2020? Are there any Isaac Newtons out there today? I'm just wondering, in this moment of interruption, what could happen if we began to see it as a moment of leverage? Now, let me get back to the Bible for a second, because I want you to see, Paul had a choice too. He could sit in this season and discount his missionary life, and he could make excuses. Instead, he chose to make progress. Do you know that while he was under house arrest, he continued to disciple young Timothy? He discipled John Mark. He discipled, who else was it? It was Epaphras and Justus. And then at the same time, he also spent time with his co-partner, Luke, and he kept growing in that small group experience with him. While he was there, you know what he also did? He wrote the book of Ephesians, the book of Colossians, the book of Philippians, and even Philemon. Come on, interrupted. And this is what he did with that time. And then at the same time, this is my favorite part, that he was under house arrest and he was chained to a Roman guard. Every 6 hours they changed guards. You know what that meant? He got four guards a day that were captive audience. I mean, he kept preaching. He kept leading. He didn't make excuses. No, he made progress. Well, could that be a word for us today? In a year of interruptions and all that we're facing. I love what Paul wrote earlier when he wrote to the Church of Rome. He says, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel because of its power of God that brings salvation to everyone who believes. First for the Jew, then for the Gentile." You see, he had a decision to make. He could have been a victim. He could have been a prisoner of his circumstances. But instead, he leveraged the moment. And look at where we are, thousands of years later, being challenged by the very words that God gave him in that moment, in that season. Listen, I know this about your life because I know it about mine. Everyone is facing uncertainty right now. All of us are facing some changes right now. And in this season, what are we going to do with it? I just want Jesus to shine. I don't want us to be known by a year of discounting what God could do and making excuses. I want us to make progress. Anybody there with me? Do you want to make? I want to keep walking in what God's calling us to do.
Now, can you relate to what Paul is facing? Fredericksburg online campus. Can you guys relate to what Paul is facing? Number two, are you facing opposition? And let's continue reading Acts. 3 days later, he called together the local Jewish leaders. When he had assembled, Paul said to them, "My brothers, although I have done nothing against our people or against the customs of our ancestors, I was arrested in Jerusalem and had handed over to the Romans. They examined me and wanted to release me because I was not guilty of any crime deserving death. The Jews objected, so I was compelled to make an appeal to Caesar. I certainly did not intend to bring any charge against my people. For this reason, I have asked to see you and talk with you. It is because of the hope of Israel that I am bound with this change. They reply, we have not received any letters from Judea concerning you. And none of our people have come to from there. There was reported or say anything bad about you. But we want to hear what your views are. For we know that people everywhere are talking against this sect. In other words, talking about the Jesus movement. They arranged to meet Paul on a certain day and came in a larger number to the place where they were staying. He witnessed to them from morning to evening and explained about the kingdom of God, and from the laws of Moses and from the prophets, he tried to persuade them about Jesus. Some were convinced by what he said, but others would not believe. Like every stop, Paul first starts reaching to his people, to the Jews. He tries to persuade them to trust Jesus. Some believe, others didn't. And that group who did not believe, they got angry and frustrated at him, and they opposed his mission. Does that sound familiar? ¿Suena familiar eso? No, I'm speaking Spanish here. Does that sound familiar? Yeah. We live in the middle of a emotional days where it's easy to cancel anyone who doesn't agree 100% with you.
That's right. That's right. What you're referring to, Yayo, is a phrase, I don't know if you've heard it in modern culture, but we call it a cancel culture. Mm. You heard of that phrase yet? If not, let me define it for you. What it means is, if we disagree about one thing, then I write you off about everything. Can I tell you, this is the culture right now we're living in. We're living in an age of outrage. We're living in an age of anxiety. We're living in an age where we let our emotions kind of lead the way. And it's showing up everywhere. It's showing up in how people are talking to one another. It's showing up, especially in the world of social media, where people will type something and repost something and share something that's so visceral and so aggressive and so hard and sharp. And yet, they'll say some things there that they might not ever say to someone if they were face to face with them. I know this is a season where a lot of emotion is bubbling up, and I'm telling you, it's easy to send that email off in such a kind of a pull the sword out kind of way and to go after someone. And I've seen this even firsthand that sometimes the cancel culture, where it gets more painful, it might have been a friend you had for 5 or 8 or 10 or maybe even 20 years. And all of a sudden you said one thing, you did one thing, and they're like, boom, done with you. I know as a pastor, man, we've been walking in this age of struggle, and there's some real challenges right now happening in our country, and you can feel it. You can even feel the division in it. And yet, you know, trying to get up here and to proclaim the word of God in a faithful way, a truthful way, and at the same time trying to walk it through in our modern culture. And I always know I'm one sermon away from someone that maybe has been here and been cared for and been discipled and walked with us for 8 or more years, and it's that one sermon that says, I'm done now, I'm out of here. And again, I'm not telling you to be sorry for me, because guess what? It's your world too. It's your world at work. It's your world in your neighborhood. It's your world with your family. We are living in a cancel culture. Are y'all with me today? Man. And it's this feeling that everything is divided. And it's like we've lost our ability to find where we can be aligned and where we can be united together. And I don't know about you, but division, man, division's exhausting. It's hard. Right now, Pastor, we've talked about this walking in a season where you're leading virtually. How do you measure that? How do you know if you're connecting there? How do you know if you're engaging there? And then this season of leading in ambiguity, it's like, oh, This is hard. This is the hardest leadership assignment that we've all had, where we're having to try to lead and navigate through all of this. And I just know this, the division that we're feeling is incredibly discouraging. Now, let me just do it this way, because I want to prove to you that we're living in a time where words can simply be triggers. And if I were to come today, at least in Stafford Campus, Fredericksburg, y'all can play along. And if you're at home, you can even see how this works. But if I just said some words, it all immediately can bring you to an emotion and maybe bring you to an opinion or at least a perspective. Here we go. Come on. COVID-19. Masks. social distancing. And later we're going to talk about vaccines. All these things, I can throw it out there and you could probably take a position right now and argue your point. Are y'all with me? And then it gets even better. Of all years to be facing a pandemic, we get an election year. All right. There's unity in that, right? And right now I could say something and it make you feel something. Democrat, Republican, feel something? I can even call names out, but I'm not going to do that because that would make it even more visceral for some of you. And all of a sudden, it gets really hard. And this is where I'm going to walk a little more careful because this is real life happening where real people have been hurt. And we could talk about this one. I could say racial unrest right now. Some of y'all would position yourself. I could say police right now. Some of y'all would position yourself. Listen, we're living in a time and age where we have forgotten that conversation is about connecting. We have forgotten that we ought to have the ability to hear and to listen and to understand, even when we don't always understand and agree. We've lost that competition. That conversation's not about connection anymore. Now it's about winning. It's about competition. Y'all know I'm right in this. It's, listen, I've got to get in a position myself in an argument where I'm already finding how I can win in this debate or this argument. And now all of a sudden, it's like, I've got to be right and somebody else has to be what? No, an idiot. Right? I mean, it's not about right, wrong anymore. It's I'm right and you're stupid. This is where we are now. And I know I got little kids. I'm sorry I said that word in church. But listen to me. It has become such a divided time. And you know what? Christians, can we be different than the world? Amen. Why do we go along with the wave of, well, I'm just going to jump in the fray? I'm not telling you to lay down your convictions. I'm not telling you to lay down your background and your narrative. I'm just saying, let's not let it be the sword where we chop each other's heads off. Man, let's go there, but let's go there ready to learn and listen and understand and grow as the people of God. These are real times where the church can't be absent. We got to be the light. Amen. And we can't be the light just doing it the rest of the way the world's doing it. Man, God's given us a different way. God's given us a different hope. Can I tell you the hot thing in the culture in Rome with the Jewish people? It's Jesus. That's fighting words when you start talking about Jesus and the followers of the way, because they felt like it threatened everything about their religion. And he did. But they would want to oppose. But you know what? I love how Pastor said. He said Paul persuaded them. At least you did it with a better accent. He persuaded them. Some believed. Some didn't. Isn't that always going to be the case? But just because someone doesn't believe doesn't mean we have to go opposing them with full force. We never know when God's going to open somebody's mind and somebody's heart to finally see things from a way where maybe they've been wrong for a long, long, long time. And God's going to finally remove the scales to help them to see that they can grow in this moment. You know, when I thought about the scriptures here, I want to go back here again. Look at verse 24 and let's look at where they were disagreeing. It says this: some were convinced by what he said, but others would not believe. So they disagreed. Verse 25, there you go. They disagreed among themselves and began to leave after Paul had made the final statement. And this is when they really got ticked off. He starts talking about the Holy Spirit. He said, the Holy Spirit spoke the truth through your ancestors. And then he quotes a passage found in Isaiah chapter 6. He says, this is what was going to happen in the future. He says, go to these people and say, you will be ever hearing, but never understanding. You will be ever seeing, but never perceiving. For this people's heart had become hard, calloused, right? They're hardly hearing with their ears, and they have closed their eyes. Otherwise, they might have seen with their eyes, they might have heard with their ears, and they could have finally understood with their hearts. And guess what could have happened for them? They could have turned, and God says, I would heal them. But then Paul went on to say, therefore, I want you to know that God's salvation has been sent, not just to us Jewish people, but has been sent to the Gentiles. And here's the good news. They will listen. Listen, when he predicted this, And you know this in your own life. You know this at your work. You know this as a parent. You know this as a spouse or a boyfriend or girlfriend. Listen, there's a difference between hearing and listening. There's a difference between seeing and hearing and understanding. And he's calling them to see and experience that there's hope for them to turn back to God. But see, some couldn't get it. And some continued to reject Jesus all the way in that day. Can I tell you today, we can look backwards and say, look at how sad what they did to Jesus. Well, let me ask you a present day question. What are you going to do with Jesus? 2020 is a year for you and me. I said it last week. It's a wake-up call year, where we look at our lives and we examine where we are with Jesus being Lord over us. I love what the late great missionary Hudson Taylor once said. Look at this quote. He said, if Jesus is not Lord of all, then he is not Lord at all. Isn't that true? He wants us to be fully surrendered in every area of our life.
Now to continue, our third point is, are you facing unknown? Are you facing an unknown? Paul is under house arrest, awaiting for trial before Rome. It's outside the Jewish leaders' hands. It is not clear what's going to happen to Paul. Nobody knows what's going to happen, what's coming next for him. It's also in the unknown our faith can get shaky. It's in the unknown where we can slack on things. But also it is in the unknown where our faith can grow. And while this situation, Paul writes a letter to the church in Philippi, and he says this in Philippians 1:21. For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. Let's read this together. For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. Paul understands the main thing. Paul gets it. Paul can face his unknown because he knows he's in God's hands. He is not afraid. Are you facing an unknown? Now, let me give you a story of an unknown that happened to me early in the year. I am the campus pastor for El Monte. That's our Spanish campus. I served for years as a worship pastor in Memphis. But now I am the lead pastor for El Monte. This is my first year in this role with this greater responsibility. I am now called to lead, and in times of the unknown, who could ever predict that COVID would happen in my first year? This is my first year, and COVID happens. Here I am announcing on March 13th through Facebook, El Monte no se va a reunir. El Monte won't gather until further notice. Can our church, our baby church, survive this interruption? Seminary does not train you for this. They don't give you the tools for this. How can we survive for multiple months as a virtual church? I will confess, it scared the mess out of me. I didn't know what to do. This is my unknown. It will be tempting to make excuses. It will be tempting to quit, and it will be tempting to walk away. As a leader, I knew I needed to make a decision. Instead of making excuses, we chose to make progress. Amen. As a team, we changed our strategy in moving into a virtual gathering, something I have never done this before. I'm good on Facebook, but don't give me other stuff. And you know what's the good news? Is that God provided. God was faithful. In the unknown, me and my team grew. I am so grateful for my worship team and my tech team. You're about to see pictures of them. They safely came during the week to learn new systems and record our online Sunday gathering. Our team, and let's leave that picture there, our team went from 6 to 12 people. This group right here came Wednesdays, came Saturdays, came Sundays to make sure everything was running. Here's one quick story. This is out of my notes. One Wednesday, we record everything. And I get a phone call by Mario, tells me, hey, Yayo, we may have to record everything again on Saturday night. So I'm here on Sunday morning recording everything. Mario is our worship leader, and he stay up for nights editing videos. Stay up for nights from 6 p.m. to 8 a.m. trying to get the word of God good on this editing. And then, guess what? He still has to work. So he still went to work. Nelson also learned new systems, new cameras, and not just learned them, but trained other people to do the same thing. And let me tell you the good news about this. On that first Sunday when we gathered, virtually gathered, one person said yes to Jesus Christ.
Amen.
One person. At the same time, Jennifer, who's our kids director, also went virtual, and we start providing resources.
He's saying virtual, if y'all didn't get that.
Virtual.
Virtual.
Fue virtual, also providing tools and resources for our Hispanic community around Stafford and Fredericksburg.
Yeah.
And we created a page called El Monte Kids. But this is something that is just so in my heart.
It's good.
The unknown challenged us.
That's right.
And the unknown brought the best of us.
That's right. That's
today, right. We got 7 people getting baptized in the
Lord.
Afternoon.
Yes, Lord.
So far,
yes,
as
Lord.
Of now. In 2 weeks from here, El Monte will be celebrating their 1-year anniversary. You can make progress or make excuses, but
can't
make both. You can make progress or make excuses, but can't make both. Today, we titled today's message, Strong Finish, Terminando Fuerte. That's how we titled this message, Strong Finish. The tension of this title is that it doesn't stop in Acts 28. It ends with Paul still living in the unknown.
Yeah.
I can add, still living faithful in the unknown.
That's good.
What will your story be? ¿Cuál va a ser tu historia? How is this unknown going to challenge you? What will your story be? And let me finish with Acts 30 to 31. For two years, Paul stayed there in his own rented house and welcomed all who came to see him. He proclaimed the kingdom of God and taught about the Lord Jesus Christ, with all boldness and without hindrance. I want to take an opportunity and say thank you to Pastor and thank you, Mount family, for calling me to be the campus pastor for El Monte. My prayer is that I will serve God with the same boldness as Paul, because we are a church for the one more.
Come on. Aren't we blessed to have Pastor Yayo on our team?
Amen.
Listen, I know we've done something a little different today in trying to do kind of a tag team thing, but I wanted to give you a window into what God is doing in our campus of reaching people in Spanish speaking and removing the barrier for people to not be able to hear good news in their language. And I thought the best way to introduce you to what God is doing is to actually let you get to experience the leader and who's leading that charge. And so, again, on behalf of our church, Pastor, we're grateful to have you in this lane, in this seat. But here's the thing, this boldness that we're speaking on, I like that Acts 28 doesn't end.
Mm.
Paul's still waiting. His trial's not over yet. And you know what I think? I think that's where God wants to keep reminding us that you got to keep being faithful while you're waiting in the trial. 2020, we're still here. What are we going to do with 2020? What's going to be the marker of our 2020? I think for some of us, well, I look back on 2020, well, I binge watch a lot of shows. I got a lot of projects done around the house that we needed to get done. Again, your yards never look better. I get it, but listen, cleaning closets, doing projects, mowing the grass, guess what? Temporary. What will be the eternal markers of 2020 in your faith? I get it. Be easy to push away. Be easy to make an excuse and say, I hope next year's better than this year. But guess what? This year's not over yet. God's not finished yet. You can make an excuse or you can keep moving forward. I believe there's some things that have been awakened in our country that God's saying, I want y'all to give some attention to these things. It's time to deal with some things that maybe you've kind of ignored and neglected and thinking they weren't that big of a deal. And it's time for the church to be the church at this hour.
Right.
It's time for us to take a spiritual step. Listen, I don't know where you are in your journey, wherever you're watching us online or at Fredericksburg campus or here. Maybe you've been a Christian for decades. Maybe you've just been a Christian a few short years or a few short months. Praise God, maybe today God's going to remove the scales from your eyes, and today you're going to begin a relationship right here, right now with Him. It's amazing how sometimes things have to be stripped away for us to finally be able to clearly see. What are you going to do? What spiritual step do you need to make right now in your faith? And God's calling you to make it. I think about our church right now. I think about our family of faith right now. People that say, I'm a Christian right now. And I want to ask you right now, are you spiritually growing, or is that something you've pushed away from in this season? You know what I believe right now? This could have been the perfect year for you to finally read through the Bible all the way through. It's a commitment that you always think, oh, I don't ever have time. And guess what? God gave that to you this year. The year's not over yet. Maybe God wants you to get in a more steady way of reading Scripture. What about your prayer life this year? How has that been? I almost hate admitting this, Pastor, but vulnerability, I think, sometimes you teach from. Can I tell you, these last 6 weeks, 8 weeks, I've had a hard time praying. Can I say that out loud? Now, y'all know what prayer is. Prayer is us talking and listening and connecting with God. And I'll say it this way. I'm still praying, but I feel like, God, are you there? God, are you listening? Because it seems like the more I pray, the worse things are getting in our world. And I'm going, God, what are you trying to say? What are you trying to do? Anybody relate to that? And when you feel like that, you know what you're tempted to do? I'm just going to stop praying. I'm just going to retreat. But see, that's when we need to do the opposite. That's when we keep showing up when we don't feel anything. Even when I don't feel it, God, even when I don't see it, God, I know you're my way maker. I'm going to keep showing up. I'm going to keep talking to you. I'm going to keep listening to your word. Right now, I know this would be the year we say, it's time to get in a group. And you're like, man, our group can't meet. We haven't met in months. Listen, I know Zoom might not be your first choice, but it's better than having zero community right now. And maybe you can find an outdoor space and y'all can start meeting. I'm just here to say everybody needs a group if you want to spiritually grow. Don't let this season be your excuse of why you've been living isolated as a Christian. I know we've just gently started back worshiping again at both campuses. And I know many of you are watching online because you're just not there yet. I get that. There's no guilt added there today. Some of you are waiting. When are y'all going to have preschool care? When are you going to have elementary? When are you going to have student ministry? Our kids want to get engaged. Listen, we're working it out. We're going to give you a date. We're going to start moving towards that. We don't know yet. But let's not push away from God in the unknown. Are y'all with me? Man, this is a chance to take a step. This is a chance for us to spiritually grow. God's trying to lead us right now. It's a wake-up call. Don't let this year be marked with excuses. Again, maybe you're here today and God's saying today is your day. Right now is your moment. This is a chance for you to trust and believe for the very first time. You see, we talk a lot about putting faith in Jesus because that's what this is all about. It's about Jesus being Lord of all. If you're here today and you would simply say, Pastor, I'm not a Christian, and you've pushed back before, don't push back today. You know what becoming a Christian is? It's you admitting that you're lost. It's you admitting that today God is finding you right where you are in your life. Now, here's a hard one for our culture. It's you admitting that you're a sinner and that you need a Savior. Would you confess that today? That you need Him? You need Him in your life? You need to be forgiven? You need to be loved and led in a new way to live a new life. What if God finds you in the middle of 2020 of all years, and this is the year of your testimony? This is the year of you becoming a Christian. What if today is your moment? Would you trust there? Would you trust there? What about this? If you're here today and you've been a Christian for a while, but you've never gone public with water baptism. We shared in the front end that today we're baptizing. You've seen people popping up and getting up and walking out. Why? They're getting ready to go get baptized. Some people have prepared for this day and they're about to get baptized. Maybe God brought you here today because you have never taken that step of baptism. Could I challenge you today to take a step? Why do we get baptized? Well, the Bible tells us that God's very Son, Jesus, got baptized. You know, when we get baptized, we're doing something that Jesus did. We're following His example. Right before Jesus left the earth, He said this. He says, I command you to go into all the world, all ethnos, come on, all nations, to preach the good news of Jesus Christ, to teach people to obey everything that I taught you, and to baptize them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. I'm asking you today, if you're a Christian at one of our campuses today and you have never been baptized, then why not right now today? Right here today. And whether today you're going to give your life to Christ and get baptized on your first day of salvation, or maybe you got saved decades ago. Some of you, your testimony is, I got saved as a teenager and I never followed through with baptism. Then why not do it today? Because you're actually obeying Scripture when you do it. Now again, I know the pushback. I know the excuses that are coming because they're easy to give in a moment of a call like this. Listen, I was at a wedding last night. I thought this was kind of interesting. I was doing a wedding up in Bristow and this guy came up to me and he goes, hey pastor, I used to go to your church. That's always interesting when you hear that. I used to go. I said, oh, you used to go. You don't now? He goes, well, I watch every now and then online. I actually don't go to church. I'm not much of a God person. I'm not much of a Bible person. But I came for a few weeks because I was intrigued and I liked it. And I actually took a step in the Alpha class and took a step. And then I haven't been back in a while, but I watch every now and then. And he goes, but you sometimes give this call to surrendering to Jesus. And then you tell us to put a hand up. He goes, I never wanted to do this. I just put both my hands in my pockets and said, I'm not doing that. And I thought, wow. He said, I just can't go there. I'm not ready to give my life there. I'm not ready to surrender there. I said, I get that. I appreciate your honesty. Thank you for that. And then I thought about today, how I'm not asking you to raise a hand. Today I'm asking you to go get in the water and get baptized. I thought, wow, that's a little bit bolder. It's not, oh, this. It's, I got to go get in and follow Scripture. Yes. Listen, if you want to understand more about the Bible, it used to be more serious than that. Do you know that when people used to follow God back in the Bible, they had to get circumcised? That makes this kind of easy. Are y'all with me? But there's a mark of a believer, and it's called baptism. Baptism. I know I got a lot of kids today. Kids, maybe you're just going to take a step towards God. Listen, that's the one age group I'm going to be a little more careful with because we want you to have understanding of why you're doing what you're doing. But parents, you may already know your kid's ready and maybe today they're going to get baptized. I don't know. We're going to let God's Spirit lead us today and I can't wait to see what God's about to do. But right now to position our hearts, listen, maybe you're watching online and you're thinking, well, I'm glad I'm not at church today. It's not too late to drive to one of our campuses. If God's speaking to you, don't put off this another day. Do it today. Do it today. Come on, I can hear the excuses. Come on, I don't have clothes. Who's saying that? I don't have clothes. Somebody awake back there? Guess what? Good news. I got clothes for you today.
Amen.
I've got t-shirts you're going to give. I got shorts. I got underwear. I got sports bras. Listen, we got it all covered. I don't want anything to get in the way. I don't want any excuse to get in the way from you doing what God's calling you to do right here, right now, today. Here we go, quickly. Number two, family member, friend's not here that I really want to see this. Listen, I get that, but this is what I love about our church. We are so tech-driven. We got amazing volunteers. Today, they're going to capture it for you, and you're going to be able to share this with anybody and everybody later today and say, look at what God's doing in my life. Listen, the world needs some good news. What if your story is going to be their good news today? Number three, here we go, here we go. I can do it later. How many times are you going to use that excuse? Online, how many times are you going to use that excuse? How about instead of later, let that excuse die today and let's follow God in obedience today. Let's trust God today as Lord of our life. Here we go, last one is this. No one is here to help me. And I know sometimes that feels the scary thing. I don't know if I can make that long walk out there by myself. Listen, somebody probably came with you. Somebody's probably with you today. Here's where you put them on the spot and say, would you go with me today? I need to go do this. Better yet, maybe it's a parent or a spouse or a friend or a small group leader. Go baptize me today. Help me do this today. I got to obey God's word today. Come on, who's God speaking to right now today? You're feeling it right now. I know, because your heart's beating fast, because God's saying, it's you. It's your turn to follow me. Come on. Both campuses, bow your heads and your hearts real quick. Right now, in Jesus' name. I know this is a bold call. I know this is scary for you right now in this moment, but I'm going to ask you right now today, if today is the day that you're going to go public, I want you right now in Jesus' name to stand up right now. Stand up, and just walk right outside this room. We got people right out there ready to meet you, ready to give you a shirt, shorts. Come on, get up right now. Go. Get up and go right now. This is you. This is your call. You know it. You know it. Don't delay any longer. Let your obedience be immediate today. Come on, Fredericksburg. Don't sit idle today. Get up. It's time. It's time to take that step. It's time to walk. Father, I know you're speaking today. I cannot wait to hear the testimonies of the people in these waters. But God, may our testimony of this year be a testimony of obedience to you. May you be Lord of all, God. May you be Lord of all as you lead our church during this broken season of division. And may you help us to be the people of God, to bring the hope of Jesus to a hurting country right now. In Jesus' name, we pray and believe. Amen. Come on, let's stand and sing.